Nutrition and Wellness on BCTV is underwritten by Kulp Chiropractic Nutrition and Wellness Center.
Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Kulp, and I'm here from Kulp Chiropractic Nutrition and Wellness Center. So today our topic is going to be for you ladies out there. We're going to talk about menopause. A little touchy subject, but lots of us have experienced this subject. So we want to give you some ideas on what you might do. So if there's a lady in your house that's suffering from menopause, having hot flashes, get her to the TV so we can watch and learn together today. So what are the signs and symptoms of menopause? They're very massive. They cover a large array of problems. Hot flashes, loss of libido, night sweats, mood swings, lack of energy, vaginal dryness, depression, weight gain, headaches, and more. So what causes these awful experiences that women tend to go through? Hot flashes are caused by vasomotor instability because of stimulation from other endocrine glands. So when the body goes through these life-changing experiences, other glands take over, and sometimes we don't work as effectively as we should. The adrenal gland tries to compensate for the low estrogen level. So if you're already stressed out and you already have adrenal dysfunction, you will suffer from hot flashes. Most women, it affects about 75% or more women, which lasts probably about a year long, their symptoms. 50% of the women are affected up to 5 years period of time. And symptoms are worse, unfortunately, in that first 1 to 2 years for most women. Other menopause symptoms could be an increased heart rate. Lots of times women in their 50s will talk about heart palpitations, headaches that they've never experienced headaches before, and then they begin to experience headaches as they're aging. Excuse me. Dizziness, weight gain, inability to sleep is a real big one for women that suffer from menopause. So we want to look at what causes all these things. Excuse me. And what might be the solution for that? There's three major causes of symptoms associated with hot flashes. The hypothyroidism, so if your thyroid's underactive, simple way to find out if you have hypothyroidism is to do what we call a basal body thermometer check. They sell thermometers, the old-fashioned thermometer, stick it under your arm. First thing in the morning, you leave it there for 10 minutes before you get out of bed. You don't get up, you don't drink anything, you don't urinate, you don't walk around. 10 minutes under your armpit, and you want to see if that body temperature gets up to 98.6. If it doesn't, and you do this for 30 days, it's likely that you have some hypothyroid issues. They may not be clinical. You may not need Synthroid or other medications to fix it. But if you have a sufficiently low level, you may need to look at having your TSH and your free T4 checked to see, is there truly a dysfunction in your thyroid? So that can be one reason for menopausal symptoms. Another reason is low iron levels. Many women towards the end of their menopausal experience, right before perimenopause, will have heavy bleeding and they'll have low iron. So we check you for anemia, we check your ferritin levels, we can check this by testing your CBC levels. Poor circulation, this is something else that can cause, can cause issues with your hot flashes. We can test for poor circulation by using a Doppler ultrasound and our thermogram, which is a heat sensing device to see if you have any problems with circulation. Blood testing for circulation, we check something called homocysteine. So if you have high homocysteine levels, you have circulatory issues possibly, and that could lead to heart issues and other physical problems. We would check your cholesterol, your HDL, that's your good cholesterol, the LDL. We check other fats in your blood. We're looking to see what may be causing this dysfunction. So some of the things women experience may not all be just hot flashes. They may be other physical problems going on. So don't just disregard it as, oh, I'm having hot flashes because you're over 50. You may be having some other physical things going on. So always have these symptoms checked out. So there's a few other major symptoms that happen with menopause. Ladies, these are things we don't like to talk about, but these are things that happen. Often women will experience painful intercourse. They'll have burning, they'll have itching, they'll have infections, recurrent infections. This is caused by the atrophy or the shrinking of the vaginal tissue, and then we begin to have these issues. And this happens secondarily to the low estrogen levels that we get. So we need to look at what can we do to prevent some of these things. There's some common sense things to do. These things don't cost anything, and they are very little, and just changing our lifestyle. So number one, regular intercourse and lubricants will help. Cotton panties allow people to breathe. Avoid substances that dry out mucous membranes. Stay away from things like alcohol, caffeine, diuretics. These are all drying out of body membranes. Avoid allergy pills unless you absolutely have to take them. Stop eating things you're allergic to. Be sure to stay hydrated. Lots of water is number one thing. And one of the problems with women as we get older, we have more frequency of urination, so we cut down on our drinking. So we need to increase hydration. 1 ounce of water for every kilogram of body weight, and not to exceed more than 3 quarts of water a day. Obviously, if you're a kidney patient, you need to follow the directions you've been given for water on that. For most of us, we should be getting close to 3 quarts of water a day. Forgetfulness is another symptom of menopause. Forgetfulness is brought on by decreased oxygen and nutrient supply to the brain. So if we don't get enough oxygen to the brain doesn't work properly. We start to have dysfunction in thinking. The brain takes about 20% of the oxygen that we ingest every day. So if you want to increase your oxygen, you want to increase your memory, you need to increase your oxygen level. How do we do that? Simple. We exercise. Increasing your heart rate, getting more blood to the brain, getting more oxygen to the brain. A good solution to this is just getting out and doing some deep breathing exercises. Even if you're not physically capable of getting up out of a chair and doing exercises, there's some great chair exercises that we offer patients. And we also just have people just learn to deep breathe. Even the COPD and patients that have respiratory conditions can learn to breathe better and breathe deeper. The most prevalent diseases associated with menopause are something we hear all the time, osteoporosis. Because of the estrogen levels, we reduce the rate of bone resorption. So now we have the risk of fracture. So we do not want to see this happen. And how do we prevent this? There's several things we do. Women should have a bone density test done to evaluate their bone health in general. It's a simple test. You can get your family doctor, your gynecologist to order a bone density test. And we also, in our office, we do something called a Prilink's D test. And that's a urinary test where we can check to see, are you a bone gainer or a bone loser? If you're a bone loser, we want to fix that, because if you continue to lose bone mass, you will eventually have osteoporosis, or osteopenia comes first. So we don't want to have that. The solution to fixing these things is following up with simple testing. Like almost every show, we talk about vitamin D. Getting some vitamin D will help bring up your bone ability to decrease your risk for osteoporosis. But as I remind everybody, vitamin D is free from the sun. But if you're covered in sunscreen, you won't get any vitamin D. But we also have to be tested for vitamin D, because we want to know how much vitamin D you have when you start. Because it's really not truly a vitamin. It is a hormone. So you don't want to take too much vitamin D, because it could be toxic. Heart disease is another thing that happens because of estrogen, promotes favorable lipid profiles and healthy circulation. So when we get older, most of the time before menopause, women have a lower risk for heart disease. Since women smoke equally as much as men do, and we have high stress jobs, we're pretty equal anymore with heart disease. We're no longer a minority there. But we do see an increase in heart disease with women after menopause. So you want to keep healthy circulation, keep your cholesterol levels down, keep a good healthy diet, eat well. So now what? We know we have all these problems as women. These are all things that we will all experience. So what do we do now? We get this awful stage in life where we call menopause. So what can you do to help relieve some of the symptoms? There's lots of things, as we talked about. Give up caffeine, give up alcohol. First off, I suggest that people do not resort to pharmaceutical treatment for menopause, since we know that in the past, what we thought was helping women, 20 years ago, we put every woman on estrogen, and we skyrocketed breast cancer in the all over the United States. Avoid synthetic hormones wherever possible. Sometimes it's not possible, but we really, really encourage women to avoid synthetic hormones. There's women that end up with a hysterectomy. Many people have hysterectomies. Look before having a hysterectomy to explore other options. It's not the end all be all to your problems. Women think they get a hysterectomy, their problems are going to go away. You will still have hot flashes after a hysterectomy. Too many women are still getting hysterectomies for benign conditions, even though the rates have dropped over the last decade. There's many women just getting a hysterectomy because they're tired of the function of what the uterus does. It's expected that at least half of the women are still prescribed a hysterectomy at some time in their life. This comes from the study that was done in San Diego Naval Hospital. It showed that a 5 out of 580 women, only 15% of those women had a hysterectomy for having a malignant disease. So the rest of the 575 women or so had a hysterectomy for other reasons that wasn't cancer. Long-term effects including accelerated aging of the ovaries. So when they just remove the uterus, the rest of the body, the ovaries will age faster. If you have a hysterectomy and maintain your ovaries, you're going to go into menopause 5 years sooner than a woman that has an intact uterus. A 35-year-old woman that has a hysterectomy has about a 7 times increased risk of having a heart attack or angina issues in her lifetime versus the woman that keeps her uterus. And it alters the rate that you lose bone. So these are lots of reasons why to keep your plumbing. It's associated with depression, and it can also have sexual consequences. Synthetic hormones, we hear lots of synthetic hormones. Research states that 30% of postmenopausal women are on estrogen, and they may develop a uterine cancer within 3 to 4 years after using that estrogen. So it's really something you should not stay on for a long period of time, and the longer you're on it, the more increased risk you have. Taking estrogen in menopause are prolonged periods of time. And some of these women are having their menstrual cycle until their 60s and 70s when they're taking estrogen. So we don't really want to do that if we don't have to. It's a normal function to end, and some estrogen drugs require metabolism in the liver. So if your liver's working really hard, this can affect liver diseases, and some women have found to be having liver tumors. Other cons for not taking estrogen drugs. There has been some concerns that the hormone replacement therapy and your blood sugar levels. So if you're a diabetic and you're taking some of these drugs, you have to really, really watch your blood sugar, and it may cause you to have elevated blood sugar. Hormone replacement therapy has increased gallstones by 2.5 times increase in women having gallbladder attacks and gallstone attacks. And it's also been related to blood clotting problems for women. So other reasons not to do that. There's some reasons you should never take hormone replacement therapy. And if you have a history of breast cancer, women should truly stay away from any kind of hormone replacements. And any types of cancer, endometrial cancer, family history of breast cancer, undiagnosed bleeding, any liver disease, impaired liver function, and or gallbladder problems, you should stay away from synthetic hormones. This was an interesting fact that I found. This was published in American Journal of Respiratory and Critical Care Medicine, came from October 1995. And in the journal, this was done by a Harvard research found that they evaluated more than 23,000 women in a nurse health study. And the women taking postmenopausal hormones were 50% more likely to suffer from asthma than women who never took hormones. This finding could help explain why severe adult onset asthma affects more women than men. And the number of asthma cases have increased in young women at puberty as well. So they may have never had asthma till they hit puberty. So it's connected to the estrogen hormones. And we'll see that women are typically more prone to asthma than men. So now what do we do? I share all these awful stories and tell you all these things about what happens when you have hot flashes and you've reached menopause, if you haven't gotten there yet. It's not to scare you. The number one thing I say today is this show is not to diagnose anything. It's just for informational purposes. Well, there's some other alternatives, so let's spend the rest of the time talking about the alternatives to synthetic hormone therapy. First, we need to reduce the synthetic estrogen dominance, and we need to increase our natural products like legumes. These come from products like flax, flaxseed, flax oil. We want to improve isoflavonoids. We want to increase our fiber. Fiber is really, really important for lots of things, but fiber binds up excessive estrogen. So eating bran, oats, psyllium, lots and lots of fruits and vegetables, ladies, more vegetables than fruits. The things that are high in roughage and high fiber, easy thing to do. Other supplements that reduce estrogen dominance is to get a digestive enzyme. A B complex vitamin will make a big difference in your stress and anxiety. And a product called DIM. It's D, capital D, capital I, capital M. It's wonderful, helping to clean up extra estrogen. So most of us have hot flashes because of too much estrogen floating around. So DIM will absorb some of that extra estrogen and carry it out as waste. So that will reduce the hot flashes. One of my favorite products is called a natural progesterone cream. It has no hormones in it. It's made from wild yams, and wild yams do not look like your yams that you buy in the grocery store. They're very stringy. You would never think of them as a yam, but when you actually see the wild yam plant, that's what it's made out of. Wild yam cream is used for hot flashes, mood changes. It's used topically, not internally, for vaginal dryness, irregular periods, for night sweats. It has lots of benefits. It's used in different ways depending on where you're at in your reproductive cycle. Ideally, if a postmenopausal woman uses it 3 weeks out of the month and takes off a week and uses the wild yam cream. I always remind women that when you're using some of these things topically, you move it around because they're fat-soluble supplements. So if you put it on your right arm all the time and you keep putting it on the right arm, eventually it won't work like it did. So you put it one day on the right arm, one day on the left arm, and then on the right side of your abdomen, the left side of your abdomen, left thigh, right thigh, and kind of rotate it around daily like a clock. That makes a huge difference on how functional it will work for you. Testing is always ideal when you're working with women with hormonal issues. So we like to do what we call clinical nutrition in our office. There's no guesswork. We're not saying, well, you look like you have this problem. Maybe that's your problem. Maybe this is your problem. We test you to make sure what you have going on. And we will tell you where your problems are coming from. So we'll do testing of like your progesterone levels, your testosterone levels, three types of estrogen, DHEA, cortisol levels, and all these hormones are important to proper balance for a woman. So it's important to have those things tested. Other things that you can eat that'll help you feel better is give up your coffee and replace it with green tea. It has lots of antioxidants in it. Remember to eat organic milk and organic food whenever possible, because guess what? Your meat, your milk, your dairy is loaded with estrogen. Why is it loaded with estrogen? Because when we give cows estrogen hormones, they make more milk. Where does that estrogen go? Into the meat of the cows. Where do we get it? In our hamburgers we eat through the drive-by windows. So think about those things. You want to cut out the estrogen in the food chain. Cut out sugar. Berries are very kind. Good fruit to eat. They're high in flavonoids, great antioxidant. Add fiber to your diet. Fiber binds up the estrogen. Seeds are good. Sunflower seeds, safflower seeds, whole grains. Avoid gluten. Increase your vitamin A. Increase your vitamin C and vitamin E and bioflavonoids. Again, from raw fruits and vegetables. Use healthy fats like olive oil, coconut oil. Drink chamomile tea. It's great for relaxing, and it's also loaded with flavonoids. My recommendations to patients without any specific problems besides menopause is to look for that organic diet. Look to the Mediterranean type diet. Number one thing too, women, is we forget about xenoestrogens. Xenoestrogens are labeled as xenohormones, and these are estrogens that work, these are chemicals that work in the body like hormones. And they come from PCBs, BPAs, and phthalates. And they come from your kitchen. They're coming from all your plasticware, all your containers that are plastic. So your plastic cups, your plastic water bottles. So we're ingesting these estrogens every day. So we need to stay away from those types of things. Go back to glass, store your food in glass. Don't heat anything up in a plastic container in the refrigerator. These are environmental toxins, and they're toxic to you. Giving up alcohol, giving up tobacco. These are, again, hormone they interrupt your hormone production. So if you're suffering from hot flashes, we need to give those things up. So look to changing what you're doing, ladies. Give up the caffeine. It also increases the estrogen level. It'll cause severe hot flashes, because if you're drinking a lot of caffeine, it creates hot flashes. And we look to something called Dandy Blend, which is a nice substance that will help you detoxify. Dandy Blend tastes like coffee, looks like coffee, but it's made from dandelion, and it has some other things in it, but it's a really nice coffee alternative, and we carry it in the store if you're looking for some. If you have excessive symptoms, can't get rid of them, consider having your thyroid checked, consider having your pituitary gland checked, get a hormonal panel done. Don't just guess, and you know, if things don't go away in a few months and you've tried some dietary changes, seek out some counseling. It's one of the things that we do in our office. We'll give you some help, we'll give you some direction, we'll test you, and we'll find out what's going on so that you don't have to suffer like this. It is a normal physiological function to go through menopause, but it's not supposed to be torture, which many women suffer from for many years afterwards. So we can often correct those things by correcting chemical imbalances, looking at your diet, supporting you in your wellness care. So don't feel like you're left alone out there, and we just wish you good luck with repairing your hormones. And so we come to the end of the half an hour again. So I just want to say, if you have any questions, you may call our office at 610-208-0404. And thanks again for tuning in to Nutrition and Wellness with Dr. Kulp. And we'll see you next month. Have a great 4th of July.
Nutrition and Wellness on BCTV is underwritten by Kulp Chiropractic Nutrition and Wellness Center.